tiny in all that air. The Philip Larkin Society podcast.
Hello and welcome to Tiny in All That Air. My name is Lynn Lockwood and I am a trustee of the Philip Larkin Society. Today we feature another recorded talk from the Society archives. This talk was given to the PLS in 2001 by Winifred Dawson. When Winifred died in 2014, Honorary Vice President Anne Thwaite wrote of her in the Guardian obituary column, "Winifred Dawson, who has died unexpectedly aged 85 after a stroke, was much loved and will always be remembered for one early relationship. As a young woman in Belfast in the 1950s, Winifred inspired five of Philip Larkin's poems, more than did any of the other women in his life. The Sweet Girl Graduate, in lines on a young lady's photograph album, was also the subject of Latest Face and of Maiden Name, with its five light sounds, of He Hears That His Beloved Has Become Engaged, and written on the day of her wedding, Long Roots More Summer to Our Side of Earth. How beautiful you were, Larkin wrote, and near and young. His biographer, James Booth, describes a romantic friendship. Larkin would have liked it to be more, and reluctantly put away his inconvenient emotions and dozens of happy memories, which, like pressed flowers, I can spend all winter arranging. There are 26 letters to win in the selected letters of Philip Larkin. Anne's obituary of Winifred goes on to describe Winifred's life, born in London but educated in Belfast, which is where she met Larkin when they were both working at Queen's University Library. Win also went on to write herself and published a biography of Amy Audrey Locke, the muse for the poet WB Yeats. Win opens with a reflection on Larkin's love for his parents. However, the talk is mainly about Larkin's relationships with the women in his life: Ruth Bowman, Winifred, Monica Jones, Patsy Strang, Maeve Brennan, who is listening in the audience, and Betty Mackereth. Ruth, Maeve and Win went on to form a friendship, having first met at Ruth's house in 1993, 8 years after Larkin died. We do actually hear a little bit of Maeve Brennan at the end of Wynne's talk. I wish we could have heard more. There is a link in the show notes to the first issue of About Larkin that features all three women, as well as a fascinating conversation between Wynne and Maeve. This is available to read on the PLS website, along with all the past About Larkins, an amazing free resource that anyone can access. In the article, Wynne and Maeve reflect on how much they have in common, not just Larkin. Betty Mackereth and Maeve Brennan are on the cover of issue 9. Monica is on issue 11, Maeve issue 16. Issue 35 features Ruth Bowman on the cover and marks her death at the end of 2012 with a tribute written by Winifred. Winifred herself is on the cover for issue 38, having passed away in August of 2014. Winifred's talk is full of humour, and it's a frank account of her feelings about Larkin, as well as wonderful readings of Larkin's poetry and letters. The poetry readings were not recorded at the time of the talk, and so we have added them in. We have also added the 1975 poem, When First We Faced, after Toads Revisited, as the second poem about Betty Mackereth. Please enjoy.
January 2000, I gave this talk, or a sort of basic version of it, to a less well-informed audience in Coventry. The local paper announced the event under the headline, "Lady Friend of Larkin to Spill Beans." Well, no such headline has appeared tonight, and I'm afraid I'm really not going to spill any beans this evening. Any that remain to be spilt will now be on their way to the Bodleian after lying hidden in Newlands Park since Philip's death in 1985. I wish I had some more to spill, but I haven't. Love and Larkin, what does that mean? What is love? solving that question would certainly bring the priest and doctor in their long coats running across the fields. Was love an important part of Philip's life? Yes, I'm sure it was, and I'm going to try and prove it tonight. Since Philip's death and the publication of the letters in Andrew Motion's life, our perspectives have changed greatly. I don't think we need now defend him against the charges of being a man with a distaste for woman, a waspish spinster, a miserable old curmudgeon, and a foul-mouthed bigot who made a small talent go a very long way, words which I hope their writers have lived to regret. That was Peter Ackroyd. In fact, Philip now stands revealed as a man with a great capacity for and need of an understanding of the needs of others for love. What else can we call the long-lasting relationships with other people, mostly women, which ran through his whole life? Consider these few lines from Faith Healing. In everyone there sleeps a sense of life lived according to love. To some it means the difference they could make by loving others, but across most it sweeps as all they might have done had they been loved. That nothing cures. And then ask if Philip knew about love. I'm going to deal mainly with Philip's relationships with women, but I think it's undeniable that he loved his parents whilst deploring their marriage. There wouldn't seem to have been anything particularly lovable about his father, Sidney, the treasurer of Coventry City Council, a stickler for efficiency, of overtly fascist sympathies, a man who kept a bust of Hitler on his office desk. But writing to Maeve Brennan many years later, Philip wrote, "When I think back on my father's funeral, I know I'd been so raked with emotion for 3 months that I was quite anaesthetized." And a few days after his father's death, which occurred when Philip was 25, he wrote this tender and affectionate poem.
An April Sunday brings the snow. An April Sunday brings the snow, making the blossom on the plum trees green, not white. An hour or two and it will go. Strange that I spend that hour moving between cupboard and cupboard, shifting the store of jam you made of fruit from these same trees. 5 loads, £100 or more than enough for all next summer's teas, which now you will not sip neat. Behind the glass, under the cellophane, remains your final summer, sweet and meaningless, and not to come again.
Philip's mother, Eva, he closely resembled her in appearance. They were both, from photographs, tall, with rather long necks and sloping shoulders, whereas his father, Sidney, according to Maeve, was quite small. So Philip resembled his mother in appearance. She excited feelings of irritation and pity in him, and he greatly feared the possibility of having to look after her for years to come when his father had died. She was to live for almost 30 more years, and Philip's attentions to her in her long widowhood went beyond the call of filial duty. It's often been said that he used her as an excuse for not becoming fully committed to another woman. She adored him and gave him the feelings of comfort that we all have whilst even one parent is alive, of another generation between us and death. Love Songs in Age, with its description of love still promising to solve and satisfy and set unchangeably in order, is often connected with Eva. And there's another poem, Reference Back, where a jazz record is described as being a bridge between your unsatisfactory age and my unsatisfactory prime, which I think is indicative of the relationship between Philip and his mother. But I'd like Robert to read the less well-known Mother, Summer, I.
My mother, who hates thunderstorms, holds up each summer day and shakes it out suspiciously. lest swarms of grape-dark clouds are lurking there. But when the August weather breaks, and rains begin, and brittle frost sharpens the bird-abandoned air, her worried summer look is lost. And I, her son, though summer-born and summer-loving, nonetheless am easier when the leaves are gone. Too often summer days appear emblems of perfect happiness I can't confront. I must await a time less bold, less rich, less clear, an autumn more appropriate.
Incidentally, thinking about Philip and his parents, could there be a more obvious example of inherited characteristics? From Sydney, Philip got a sort of powerful, clear mind, a genius for efficiency in getting things done, a refusal to suffer fools gladly. From Eva, gentleness, diffidence, a tendency to indecision, and an interest in domestic details to a degree unusual in a young man. I think Maeve would agree with me there. To the end of his life, Philip had a great interest in the details of domestic life, either his own or other people's, which was really quite touching. And I'm sure he inherited that from his mother. Philip's early years were notably thin in female relationships. He didn't get on with his sister Kitty, who was about 10 years older than he was. But he must have come across little girls at his nursery school, and was famously attracted by a pair of fur-backed gloves, the sort of thing all little girls liked before the days of animal rights. Apparently, when he went to kindergarten in Coventry, he noticed a little girl who had fur-backed gloves. And that occurs much later in a poem called Wild Oats. There were fur-backed gloves. Because of his stammer, extreme short sight, a need of very thick spectacles, and a general feeling of unattractiveness, Philip was very shy, and he had great difficulty in making any approaches whatever to girls all through his youth. He was educated, of course, at a single-sex grammar school, King Edward's VIII in Coventry, and an all-male Oxford College, St John's. It wasn't till he had graduated and, like myself, not knowing what to do next, somehow found himself taking on the job of librarian in Wellington, Shropshire, that he broadened out into relationships with women as well. He was still only 21 when he arrived in Wellington in Shropshire for the job of public librarian. Here his paternal inheritance began to emerge as he completely reorganized the antiquated library system. But in Wellington began his first important relationship with a girl, Ruth Bowman, who was only 16 and still at school when she first asked for his help in finding a library book. This is all well documented in Motion's biography. Their shared enthusiasm for books drew them together, and Ruth, whose adored father had died when she was 11, became very dependent on the courteous, helpful librarian, who was probably a rather middle-aged young man, when you think he was only about 21. The attachment between Ruth and Philip grew slowly, and they seemed to be drifting towards marriage, but with lessening enthusiasm on the part of Philip, who, under the influence of his friends Kingsley Amis and Bruce Montgomery, whom I like to think of as two literary men behaving badly, was beginning to realise the implications of giving up his freedom. When one reflects that Philip was only 25 and Ruth a few years younger, and that the only marriages they had known were extremely traditional ones, with a closeness unbearable if there were the slightest degree of marital disharmony, Philip's phrase, I'm not surprised that Philip got cold feet. The Larkins' marriage would have been accounted a success. It lasted till death. Sydney and Eve were presumably faithful to each other, and they fulfilled their traditional roles of earning the money and keeping the house. but Philip wrote during his time at Wellington, "Let me remember that the only married state I know intimately, i.e. that of my parents, is bloody hell. Never let this be forgotten." But at this time, Philip had not even become engaged to Ruth, and perhaps he can be blamed only for indecision and dither at this time, soon after his father's death, when he was faced with the prospect of doing something about his mother to prevent her from becoming an albatross about his neck. It cannot be said that the relationship between Philip and Ruth produced happy poems celebrating the joys of first love. As many of you will know, I don't know if some people know, Ruth lives about 7 miles from me in Hampshire, and we often meet for a womanly chat or a shopping expedition. We don't necessarily mention Philip at all, you know, plenty of other things to talk about, cats and grandchildren and expeditions and films and books. But I see her once or twice a month, and I can talk to her about this. When I asked her which poem summed up their relationship, her answer was, "No Road." That poem was written in 1950, when they had already parted. In a poem called Wild Oats, Philip wrote about that parting. "Parting, after about 5 rehearsals, was an agreement that I was too selfish, withdrawn, and easily bored to love. Well, better to get that learnt." But first, I'd like us to hear 2 beautiful short poems written about 1944, showing the cast of Philip's thoughts at the time. I love these poems from the North Ship with their intense imagery of cold and sailing ships.
Within the dream, you said, "Let us kiss then, in this room, in this bed. But when all's done, we must not meet again." Herein this last word, there was no lambing night, no gale-driven bird, nor frost-encircled root as cold as my heart. No Road. Since we agreed to let the road between us fall to disuse, and bricked our gates up, planted trees to screen us, and turned all time's eroding agents loose, silence and space and strangers, our neglect has not had much effect. Leaves drift unswept, perhaps, grass creeps unmown, no other change. So clear it stands, so little overgrown. Walking that way tonight would not seem strange, and still would be followed. A little longer, and time would be the stronger, drafting a world where no such road will run from you to me. To watch that world come up like a cold sun, rewarding others, is my liberty. Not to prevent it is my will's fulfilment, willing it my ailment.
By the time Philip and Ruth parted, he'd already taken up a post in the library of Leicester University, a strange building which had formerly been a lunatic asylum, a grim joke much to Philip's taste. And there he met a very different woman, Monica Jones. Since Monica's death in February, we may feel we know a little more about the facts of her life, but her relationship with Philip was very private, and her unwillingness to speak or write about it, in addition to her apparent lack of close friends, leave her as an enigmatic figure amongst Philip's women. Monica was an assistant lecturer in the English department at Leicester, and therefore bookish like Ruth. But she took a more cynical, even iconoclastic view of literature, not subscribing to prevailing league tables of literary figures past and present. This would have appealed greatly to Philip, a man who submitted an essay to his Oxford tutor, bravely arguing that Gower was a greater poet than Chaucer. And perhaps he was, but I think Philip was very brave to say so. Monica's sexuality was much more visible than Ruth's. She wore bright colours, which Philip maintained always mean a woman is available. She favoured fishnet tights and very short skirts, and liked to wear an outfit appropriate to the subject of her lecture. Now, Philip was always intensely interested in women's clothes, as Maeve and I both remember from our library days. Not just ours, but everyone's. So all this must have been heady stuff to him. Monica himself said that when they met, she recognised an iron selfishness in each of us. This may have been true when they were 25. But over the years, Philip had to spread himself much more broadly. His obligations to his mother, his responsible and high-profile job, not only as university librarian, but also as an increasingly well-known literary figure, as well as his numerous friendships with men and women, which had to be kept up, eroded this selfishness, leaving only a tiny core necessary to safeguard his independence. Monica, on the other hand, directed her life along a narrower beam and ended up by putting all her eggs in one basket. Meanwhile, they enjoyed many things together. Because Monica had an established career, there was no need for the moment to think of marriage. They particularly enjoyed holidays together and travel in a modest way. They went to Sark, to Skye, to the Lake District, to the remoter parts of Britain. But they never went abroad, which for some reason or other they both detested. They walked, played Scrabble, ate and drank with some gusto, and famously enjoyed defacing books with rude words and drawings, which is probably good therapy for a librarian and a lecturer in English, constantly dealing with books which they privately hated. I felt like doing that myself. Of the poems most closely associated with Monica, Show Saturday, which is beautifully detailed and expressed, commemorates expeditions from the cottage she owned in Hayden Bridge, Northumberland, where Philip often spent time. But that is a long poem. But because of its date, 1960, and because of the shared holidays and undoubtedly sexual nature of their relationship, Talking in Bed is one of the poems I have chosen for Robert to read. And for a lighter touch, Poem About Oxford for Monica, written on the flyleaf of Betjeman's An Oxford University Chest and never published during Philip's lifetime.
Talking in Bed. Talking in bed ought to be easiest. Lying together there goes back so far, an emblem of two people being honest. Yet more and more time passes silently. Outside, the wind's incomplete unrest builds and disperses clouds about the sky, and dark towns heap up on the horizon. None of this cares for us. Nothing shows why, at this unique distance from isolation, it becomes still more difficult to find words at once true and kind, or not untrue and not unkind.
Poem About Oxford, for Monica. City we shared without knowing, in blacked out and butterless days till we left and were glad to be going, unlike the arse-licker who stays. Does it stick in our minds as a touchstone of learning and la politesse? Well, the old place hadn't much tone. Two others we know have got less. Perhaps not. And yet so much is certain. Aside from more durable things, I'm glad you don't say you're from Girton. You'd sooner I wasn't at King's. To all that it meant, a full note case, dull bodley, draught beer, and dark blue, and most often losing the boat race. You're added, as I am for you. So 30 years on, when the cake queues and coffees have gone by the board, and new men in new labs make breakthroughs, old buildings are cleaned and restored, and students live up to what's said about their like in black papers and more, it holds us like that flea we read about in the depths of the Second World War.
Well, we have to keep going backwards and forwards, as Philip's loves don't fit into any sort of neat time slots. So I'm going back to 1950. Ruth has been disposed of, not without great guilt. Monica is a sort of ongoing presence in Philip's life, but as they're both busy working, they don't have to spend too much time together. Eva, now a widow, is temporarily making a home for Philip and would like him to continue living with her. Philip is 28. It's time to move on. A clean sheet, a tabula rasa, a place with no memories or associations. This is what Belfast meant to Philip when he arrived in the early autumn of 1950. For this ignorance of me seems a kind of innocence. Fast enough shall I wound it. Let me breathe till then its milk-aired Eden, he wrote in Arrival. Philip, for the moment, was leaving behind all his entanglements, or so he thought. But he was a man so needy of human relationships that he hadn't a hope in hell of freeing himself from those already established. He was soon to accumulate even more. He began work in October in the strange Gothic pile of the Library of Queen's University. Now, this had been designed by the architect of the House of Commons, Barry, and it was a really Gothic building. And the library had, it was freezing. It had, the roof was about 50 feet high, and there were a few odd seats dotted around, but it wasn't cosy, not like most libraries now. Anyway, Philip began work there in October 1950, and within a few days, he meets me.
Latest face. So effortless your great arrival at my eyes. No one standing near could guess your beauty had no home till then. Precious vagrant, recognise my look and do not turn again. Admirer and admired embrace on a useless level where I contain your current grace, you my judgment. Yet to move into real untidy air brings no lasting attribute, bargains, suffering and love. Not this always planned salute. Lies grow dark around us. Will the statue of your beauty walk? Must I wade behind it till something's found, or is not found, far too late for turning back? Or, if I will not shift my ground, is your power actual? Can denial of you duck and run, stay out of sight and double round, leap from the sun with mask and brand and murder and not understand?
I must say that is not at all how it seemed to me from the fastness of the cataloguing room in the library. But then I wasn't a poet. That summer I had graduated in English literature with incredibly no ideas on what to do next. And as Maeve said, I drifted into a temporary job as an assistant cataloguer in place of one Monica Popper, who had gone to do a librarianship course at University College London. Like Philip, I found myself at a crossroads. I'd had one intense love affair, which had ended when the man had graduated and gone to work in Australia, and a number of lesser boyfriends were giving me grief. Philip and I were the only members of the staff, which numbered about 24, who were technically English. Although my father was a genuine Ulsterman, my mother was English, and I'd lived in England till I was 10 and was sent to Ireland to escape the war. We didn't live at home. We had English accents, not the salt rebuff of speech insisting so on difference, as Philip called the Ulster accent. We had a great deal in common, and though I can't remember this, we must have very soon realised that we were on the same wavelength. We spent countless hours discussing life and love, marriage and families. Some of Philip's ideas on these subjects were new to me and quite shocking. For instance, he told me on the top of a tram going down the Ormo Road that people only had children to look after them in their old age. I was shocked. I'd been brought up in a family where marriages seemed to be reasonably happy. Or if that was not the case, then the nasty bits were swept under the carpet. Certainly that was so on my father's side, a line of hard-working, God-fearing Ulster Protestants, though my mother's family of clerical descent with tendencies to artiness, fecklessness, and escape to the bottle was much more colourful, and there would be occasional hushed rumours about my numerous uncles. There were books to discuss. We were very much into early Betjeman and Catherine Mansfield, whose writing Philip admired. He tried to convert me to some of his favourite books, which he tried out on all his women friends. Jean remembers some of the same ones. In particular, Flann O'Brien's At Swim Two Birds, which no woman I know has ever been able to read. And the dreadful month-long book, The Young Girls. But he succeeded with The Real Charlotte by Somerville and Ross, which has been one of my favourite books ever since. Philip particularly enjoyed hearing stories of my life at boarding school. Only a modest establishment, evacuated during the war and housed in an eccentric Huguenot castle 20 miles from Belfast down the Ards Peninsula. It seemed strange at the time that he should want to know about such things. I remember him asking me once what was the worst thing about the war for me, and without thinking too hard, I said, not being able to get any proper elastic. Because in those days, we all wore navy blue school knickers with elastic round the legs. And when it began to wear, the legs fell down. One felt very undignified indeed. Philip, of course, loved hearing things like that. But I didn't know about his interest in schoolgirl stories. Not really. We'd walk down to a cafe in Bradbury Place at lunchtime for a modest bowl of soup, or take a sandwich to the Botanic Gardens, dreamy and autumnal. Of course, I often visited his eyrie, his top flat in Elmwood Avenue, where he might make me the odd poached egg. And this is where I yielded up the album. He showed me his, but with several pages taped together. Was it Ruth or Monica? And where is it now? Now, at this some time after this, he wrote the lines on a young lady's photograph album.
At last you yielded up the album, which once open sent me distracted. All your ages had matte and glossy on the thick black pages. Too much confectionery, too rich. I choke on such nutritious images. My swivel eye hungers from pose to pose. In pigtails, clutching a reluctant cat, or furred yourself, a sweet girl graduate. Or lifting a heavy-headed rose beneath a trellis, or in a trilby hat, faintly disturbing that in several ways. From every side you strike at my control, not least through this disquieting chaps who loll at ease about your earlier days. Not quite your class, I'd say, dear, on the whole. But oh, photography, as no art is faithful and disappointing, that records dull days as dull, and hold its smiles as frauds, and will not censor blemishes like washing lines, and hauls distemper boards, but shows the cat as disinclined, and shades a chin as doubled when it is, what grace your candour thus confers upon her face. How overwhelmingly persuades that this is a real girl, in a real place, in every sense empirically true. Or is it just the past? Those flowers, that gate, these misty parks and motors, lacerate simply by being over. You contract my heart by looking out of date. Yes, true, but in the end, surely, we cry not only at exclusion, but because it leaves us free to cry. We know what was, and won't call on us to justify our grief, however hard we yowl across the gap from eye to page. So I am left to mourn, without a chance of consequence, you, balanced on a bike against a fence, to wonder if you'd spot the theft of this one of you bathing, to condense, in short, a past that no one now can share. No matter who's your future, calm and dry, it holds you like a heaven, and you lie unbearably lovely there, smaller and clearer as the years go by.
This is a relationship described in Andrew Motion's book as a flirtation. I was very angry when I read that. I hadn't read the draft of the book before it was published. Andrew Motion knew nothing about it. I mean, it was an ongoing, affectionate colloquy, if you like, talking. I didn't know what Philip felt about me, but there was nothing about it that was a flirtation. I knew very early on that Philip didn't want to marry, though he sometimes fantasized about it. And physically, he didn't attract me. He was a lot older than I was, and I suppose I was used to young men. But not for a long time did I realize that he was attracted to me. I loved his company, and as Ruth said, he was never dull. haven't finished with me yet, but I've got a digression. After only a year at Queen's, I in turn went over to University College London to do my postgraduate diploma, not thinking I would ever go back. Lonely in London, I formed a new relationship with a postgraduate student based on a shared passion for music, everything from madrigals to Wagner, but not Philip's sort. Philip wrote to Jim Sutton that I was into really horrible music. Philip really loathes madrigals. I don't know whether you know the episode from Lucky Jim where he suddenly finds he's got to sing madrigals. Well, Philip loathes madrigals. And years afterwards, when my son had grown up to be a professional drummer, wrote to me, "It doesn't seem fair somehow. I bet if I'd had a son, he would have sung madrigals." But he had never attempted to introduce me to jazz, of which I was totally ignorant. Whilst I was in London, and partly when I wasn't, Philip was taken over by Patsy Strang. Now, I'd heard him with my own ears expressing the opinion that married women were out of bounds, but this would not have stopped Patsy. She was an experienced, sophisticated, rich young woman with a semi-detached husband and nothing much to do. A doctor who didn't practice, a woman who had been to Rodin and Somerville. Philip and I used to wonder what made her tick and how someone with so many advantages could be so bored. She was already dependent on drink, and she couldn't get through a film without producing a little bottle from her pocket. I was terrified of her, and of course she hadn't much use for women. Her character is laid bare in her novel Playing the Harlot, published only a few years ago from her papers in the University of Tulsa, a book which I think is brilliant, but nobody else seems to share my opinion. I think it's brilliant. Philip and Patsy had an intense but short-lived relationship, of which the outstanding event revealed only a few years ago was that she apparently became pregnant by Philip. Now, you would think that Philip would have been thrown into an absolute panic by this news, but he seems to have taken it with amazing sang-froid and made no attempt to deny his paternity, writing to Patsy, "Dear Honeybun, oh dear, not the best of news, I agree. I wish I were near at hand to make it seem less of an enormity. However, you needn't worry about being left abandoned under piles of wool and ribbons. After feeling sorry and alarmed and guilty, I find it rather thrilling." But Kingsley wrote, "So Patsy's in pod, eh? I should think of all my acquaintances, she is the worst equipped person to be a parent I've ever met. Devotedly undertaken, conscientiously pursued emotional incompetence, such as I read in her, is an ill qualification." Sorry if I seem to be nasty about Patsy, but she was nasty about me. There's a fuller account of her relationship with Philip in New Larkins for Old by George Gilpin. Goodness knows how Philip would have coped if the event had ever come to pass, Patsy still being married to Colin Strang. But fortunately for him, the child fell victim to one of her frequent miscarriages. Her affair with Philip, based on the thrills of sex and secrecy, began to cool and fall apart. I can't think that Philip ever loved her, but he felt sympathy over her sad life and was shocked and saddened when she died from drink and barbiturates when she was 50. I've been unable to find a poem directly inspired by her. But after she left Belfast for good in the summer of 1953, Philip, bereft of the excitement she had provided, and wondering what had happened to his dreams of a new life in Belfast, wrote this.
"At 31, when some are rich and others dead, I, being neither, have a job instead, but come each evening back to a high room above deep garden fulls of air, on which already has been laid an autumn bloom. And here, instead of planning how I can best thrive, how best win fame and money while alive, I sit down, supper over, and begin one of the letters of a kind I now feel most of my spare time is going in. I mean, letters to women. No, not of the sort the papers tell us get read out in court, leading directly to or from the bed. Love letters only in a sense.
They owe too much elsewhere to come under that head. Too much to kindness, for a start. I know none better, the eyelessness of days without a letter. Too much to habit. Stop, but why on earth? Too much to an unwillingness to part with people wise enough to see my worth. I'm kind, but not kinetic. Don't enlist a word simply because its deed has been deferred. Ends in themselves. My letters plot no change. They carry nothing dutiable. They won't aspire, astound, establish, or estrange. Why write them then? Are they in fact just compromise? Amiable residue, when each denies the other's want? Or are they not so nice, stand-ins in each case simply for an act? Mushrooms of virtue or toadstools of vice? They taste the same. So summer ends, and nights draw in, another evening wasted. I begin writing the envelope, and a bitter smoke of self-contempt, of boredom too, ascends. What use is an endearment and a joke?
So this is a poem about writing letters to women, stand-ins in each case simply for an act. But look what might happen when an act took place. It might change your life irrevocably and in the wrong direction. So it was safer just to go on writing to Monica and to me. Yes, I was still around, although I had not expected to go back to work at Queen's. The temporary absence of another member of staff who had boldly written to the University of Addis Ababa to see if there was a job going, since she was interested in early Christianity and had been accepted, meant that I was asked to return for another year, this time as chief cataloguer at a princely salary of £400 a year. Now I qualified as a junior lecturer, could join the staff club, and thus began to see a lot more of Philip. We were often asked together to modest parties at other dons' houses. And I began to have some glimpses into the exciting world of the future, lifestyle and things. One couple had a room decorated entirely in grey, white and red, which was very avant-garde in Ulster. Another produced salad containing things like oranges and grapes, and garlic began to announce its presence. Philip was fascinated. A bit of him secretly fancied becoming part of this society, and he began to say things like, "If we were married." The great Sunday dinner versus going to the pub debate was now on, and in this cause he gave me a copy of William Cooper's Scenes from Provincial Life, inscribed "A novel about Leicester and not getting married." But I wanted to get married. More particularly, I had a biological urge to have a baby. And over New Year 1953, I became engaged to the man who was to become my first husband. When I got back to Queen's in January, in a particularly emotional atmosphere because of a plane crash in which several students had been killed, and separately a beloved old member of staff, Wilfie, had died of a heart attack, and showed my ring, Philip was gobsmacked, or horrible word, anyway, it's true. I feel as if someone had handed me a new manuscript by D.H. Lawrence and I'd left it sitting on my desk till after Christmas only to find it gone, he said. I have almost total recall of this period, so intense was it. And I notice that it was now there begin to occur letters in the Larkin-Amis correspondence about me, with Kingsley giving typically robust advice to Philip as to how he should proceed to get me back, and chiding Philip for pussyfooting and indecision. "Plunge your hand down the front of her blouse, why don't you?" Advice which Philip did not follow. It goes without saying that it was the very fact of my engagement which gave an added edge to Philip's feelings for me. If I'd broken it off, he would no doubt have hastily retreated. I have no illusions on this point. But my engagement and marriage, which of course didn't endure as I made it for all the wrong reasons, inspired at least three poems, though two of them are not amongst his best. These are "He Hears That His Beloved Has Become Engaged" and "Long Roots More Summer to Our Side of Earth," which is headed with the date of my wedding. But "Maiden Name" has endured and is my favourite amongst my poems.
Maiden Name. Marrying left your maiden name disused. Its five light sounds no longer mean your face, your voice, and all your variants of grace. For since you were so thankfully confused by law with someone else, you cannot be semantically the same as that young beauty. It was of her that these two words were used. Now, it's a phrase applicable to no one. Lying just where you left it, scattered through old lists, old programmes, a school prize, or two packets of letters tied with tartan ribbon. Then is it scentless, weightless, strengthless, wholly untruthful? Try whispering it slowly. No, it means you. Or, since you're past and gone, it means what we feel now about you then. How beautiful you were, and near, and young, so vivid. You might still be there amongst those first few days, unfinger-marked again. So your old name shelters our faithfulness, instead of losing shape and meaning less with your depreciating luggage laden.
I can't honestly say that I feel Philip loved me. We didn't know each other for long enough, but we had a bond of affection which might have grown if our relationship had been longer. As it was, I had to leave Queens, where there was no longer a job for me, and work in Birkbeck College, London, which I hated so much that I stifled doubts about my engagement and married in the end just to get away from London. Of course, I broke completely with Philip, and in revisionist mode, he wrote some harsh things about me. But 20 years later, when my first marriage was over, we began to write to each other again, which was a great delight. I married in 1954, and Philip remained in Belfast till 55, when he moved on to Hull. Here I begin to feel nervous, because there are many people in this room who know far more about Philip's years in Hull than I do, and especially Maeve Brennan, in whose presence I feel presumptuous in addressing the whole subject of love and Larkin. I have had the great privilege and pleasure of reading a large selection of the correspondence between Maeve and Philip, spanning the years from 1960 to 1975, and seen Philip in an entirely different light. Her relationship with Philip grew slowly over many years. She broke off a previous engagement when she became attached to him. Her innocence and sheer niceness brought out the best in him, and her house is full of sentimental little and not so little objects. He brought her as gifts wherever he went. And yet, of course, Monica was still part of his life, still living and working in Leicester till 1981, spending time with Philip in her cottage and on summer holidays, and he was taking her with him on some official outings. It isn't possible now to go into all the complications of Philip's life during those years. It's all well documented in Motion's book. How accurately only those involved can tell. With Maeve's permission, I'd like to read three extracts from their correspondence. And I've already obtained that permission. Maeve to Philip, 14th of September, 1967. I know full well you are not going to marry either of us. Monica must know it too. I think there is ample room for both women in this triangle, given you at its apex. Philip to Maeve, 1 week later. All I can say is that I'm often made unhappy by the situation. I'm not a philanderer. I'm not accustomed to keeping lots of girls on a string. I'm extremely faithful by nature. The trouble with me is that there are lots of less laudable characteristics in me as well, I suppose. Maeve to Philip, the 3rd of November, 1975. I loved our weekend with all its thrilling associations. It's funny how it was almost a repetition of the same weekend last year, with equally beautiful weather. It's very hard for me to believe that after all this time I have not grown stale for you. Needless to say, it is also the most wonderful thing that ever happened to me. It wouldn't be like that with a marriage partner after 14 or 15 years, so look what we have gained. These letters, written over a period of many years, give a vivid picture of what must have been Philip's happiest, most loving relationship, and are amongst the most delightful love letters I've ever come across. How we should like to read his letters to Monica, but I gather that will not be in the lifetime of most of us here. The letters are a mixture of domestic detail, professional affairs, I've written this in, and all showing the greatest concern and consideration for other people. Philip was always very careful, you know, to be there for his staff, to remember people who were ill. I mean, he was amongst the most considerate of men. In the end, Monica won. Her desperate need of Philip, especially in the 4 years between her retirement and his death, during which she lived a strangely geriatric life with him in Newlands Park, meant that at last they came near to the practicalities of marriage. He felt they had grown old together, our walking sticks hung side by side in the hall. But it was Maeve who inspired the best of Philip's later love poems, and I'd like us to hear two of them, to begin with, Broadcast and Morning at Last, both of which refer to real incidents in their long relationship.
Broadcast. Giant whispering and coughed from vast Sunday full and organ frowned on spaces, precede a sudden scuttle on the drum, the Queen, and a huge resettling. Then begins a snivel on the violins. I think of your face among all those faces, beautiful and devout, before cascades of monumental slithering. One of your gloves unnoticed on the floor, beside those new, slightly outmoded shoes. Here it goes quickly dark. I lose all but the outline of the still and withering leaves on half-empty trees. Behind the glowing wave bands, rabid storms of cording, by being distant, overpower my mind, all the more shamelessly. Their cut-off shout, leaving me desperate to pick out your hands, tiny in all that air, applauding.
Morning at last. There in the snow, your small blunt footprints come and go. Night has left no more to show, not the candle, half-drunk wine, or touching joy. Only this sign of your life walking into mine. But when they vanish with the rain, what morning woke to will remain, whether as happiness or pain.
I can't bring this talk to a close without mentioning Betty Mackereth, who in a way was a digression, a side road off the Monica Maeve motorway. But side roads have their own charm and usefulness when the motorway gets too hectic. Betty, as is generally known, is a practical, efficient, no-nonsense woman who, as Philip's secretary, knew things about him which neither Maeve nor Monica did. There is some doubt about which poems might be connected with her, and I'd better not enter into that controversy, but one certainly is. She is the loaf-haired secretary in Toads Revisited.
Toads Revisited. Walking around in the park should feel better than work. The lake, the sunshine, the grass to lie on. Blurred playground noises beyond black stocking nurses. Not a bad place to be. Yet it doesn't suit me. Being one of the men you meet of an afternoon, palsied old step-takers, hair-eyed clerks with the jitters, wax-fleshed outpatients still vague from accidents, and characters in long coats deep in the litter baskets, all dodging the toad work by being stupid or weak. Think of being them. Hearing the hours chime, watching the bread delivered, the sun by clouds covered, the children going home. Think of being them. Turning over their failures by some bed of lobelias. Nowhere to go but indoors. No friends but empty chairs. No, give me my in-tray, my loaf-haired secretary, my, shall I keep the call in, sir? What else can I answer when the lights come on at 4 at the end of another year? Give me your arm, old toad. Help me down Cemetery Road.
When first we faced and touching showed how well we knew the early moves,
behind the moonlight and the frost, the excitement and the gratitude. There stood how much our meeting owed to other meetings, other loves. The decades of a different life that opened past your inch-close eyes belonged to others, lavished, lost, nor could I hold you hard enough to call my years of hunger strife back for your mouth to colonise. Admitted, and the pain is real. But when did love not try to change the world back to itself? No cost, no past, no people else at all. Only what meeting made us feel, so new and gentle, sharp and strange.
One critic has said, in Hull, Larkin too loved two women and quietly ruined both their lives. But did he? Maeve was one of those women and she disagrees with that. How could he have made a choice? He needed both Maeve and Monica. When my relationship with Philip ended on my marriage, he wrote to Kingsley, well, that's one life I haven't ruined, mine. And he continued to think that marriage would ruin his life, though with Maeve he seriously contemplated it. But he stuck to his guns, and his resolve must have been steeled by the marital disharmony which led to the breakdown of so many of his friends' marriages, the Amises, Strangs, Hartleys, Edgertons, Murphys, Motions, and my own. Yet his words, the instantaneous grief of being alone, from the poem Kick Up the Fire, show that solitude also had its pains. Of course he loved, and greatly. He was not a misogynist, but a misogamist. Here are two of the poems he wrote on his difficulties. To My Wife was written in 1951, 6 months after he met me. Counting is a tiny poem unpublished in his lifetime, which deserves to be better known.
To My Wife. Choice of you shuts up that peacock fan the future was, in which temptingly spread all that elaborative nature can. Matches potential, but unlimited, only so long as I elected nothing. Simply to choose stopped always up but one, and sent the tease birds from the bushes flapping. No future now, I and you now, alone. So for your face I've exchanged all faces, for your few properties bargained the brisk baggage, the mask and magic man's regalia. Now you become my boredom and my failure, another way of suffering, a risk, a heavier-than-air hypostasis.
Counting. Thinking in terms of one is easily done. One room, one bed, one chair, one person there. Makes perfect sense. One set of wishes can be met. One coffin filled. But counting up to two is harder to do, for one must be denied before it's tried.
However, since this is supposed to be a reflection on love and Larkin, we must end with the poem containing his most famous line about love, An Arundel Tomb.
An Arundel Tomb. Side by side, their faces blurred, the Earl and Countess lie in stone, their proper habits vaguely shown as jointed armour, stiffened pleat, and that faint hint of the absurd, the little dogs under their feet. Such plainness of the pre-Baroque hardly involves the eye, until it meets his left-hand gauntlet, still clasped empty in the other, and one sees with a sharp tender shock his hand withdrawn, holding her hand. They would not think to lie so long. Such faithfulness in effigy was just a detail friends would see. A sculptor's sweet commissioned grace thrown off in helping to prolong the Latin names around the base. They would not guess how early, in their supine stationary voyage, the air would change to soundless damage, turn the old tenantry away. How soon succeeding eyes begin to look, not read. Rigidly they persisted, linked through lengths and breadths of time, Snow fell undated. Light each summer thronged the glass. A bright litter of bird calls strewed the same bone-riddled ground. And up the paths the endless altered people came, washing at their identity. Now, helpless in the hollow of an unarmorial age, a trough of smoke in slow suspended skeins above their scrap of history, only an attitude remains. Time has transfigured them into untruth. The stone fidelity they hardly meant has come to be their final blazon, and to prove our almost instinct, almost true, what will survive of us is love.
Well, Win, that was really most moving. I hadn't thought you were going to speak so much about my relationship with Philip, but it really brought tears in my eyes.
Thank you to Jim Warren for the original recording and sleeve notes. Thank you to Graham Chesters, Simon Smith, Daniel Vince, Phil Pullen, Clarissa Hard, Rachel Gallatly, Alex Davis, Gavin Hogg and Julian Wilde for reading the poem so beautifully. Philip and I will be doing more research into Winifred later in the year, and we're planning a second podcast and a recording for our YouTube channel. So, moving on, I'm really excited to be able to confirm the date of the next Philip Larkin Society conference, which will take place at the University of Hull on the 14th to 15th of March next year, 2024. We're in the early stages of planning, but we know we'll be celebrating 50 years since the publication of High Windows, one of the 20th century's greatest collection of poems. The conference will have an academic element, but we are aiming to make it as accessible and engaging as last year's, which was a great success. And we hope to hear from writers, musicians, artists and Larkin fans, as well as academics. Please keep an eye out for the call for papers in the autumn and the chance to register your attendance later in the year, as well as general news and updates. Thank you for listening to the podcast. Just by subscribing and listening, you're helping to support us. And by sharing, liking, reviewing, you can also show your support. If you're not already a member, then please consider joining. You will receive 2 printed copies of About Larkin a year and a chance to have your say in the direction of the Society through attendance at the AGM, deciding on future trustees and so on. You also have access to any member-only events that we hold, and help us to fulfil our charitable aim of promoting the knowledge and appreciation of Larkin's work and that of his contemporaries. This podcast was produced by me, Lynn Lockwood and Gavin Hogg, and the music was The Horns of the Morning by The Mechanicals Band. If you have any questions, comments or ideas for future topics, then please, as ever, do get in touch.
Of the morning are blowing, are shining. The meadow is wet with the coldest of dew. The dawn reassembles.